Thank you. Congregation of the United States. Congregation, it truly is my privilege to be here today, and for a variety of reasons, to participate here this afternoon. There's only a handful of people here today who can remember back a number of years ago to, I believe, a weekend in spring when Janet Thayer found out that she was going to have some problems in life when we were in junior high. And I can remember that. I think, if I'm not mistaken, I'm going from memory 100%. That was about Easter weekend, wasn't it? And I remember that Easter sunrise service. And we had a little fellowship hall over on Harvey Avenue that we were using at the time, the Voice Church. And news spread around throughout the breakfast. That's where the news circulated that morning. And it's been a very, this is at times difficult time. One of a handful of people here who can remember when your pastor and your pastor's wife became engaged. And several of our friends said to him, "Carl, why?" Now, Carl just said, it's time to get on the line. It's time to move on. I had the honor of being here the day that Amy Catherine came into the world at McGee Women's Hospital in Pittsburgh, Tennessee. And I remember that day. I remember what I was doing that day. I can say, with all honesty of heart, your parents were probably happier to introduce you as a newborn baby than as a newlywed wife. For many of you, look absolutely beautiful here today. And it is just to say to you that God's providence has been upon you and your family. And He will bless your marriage as He guides and directs you and Josh throughout the years to come. Congregation, we bow our heads for the word of prayer. And Father, as we do come to this point, in this place, we know that it is not by accident. You know better than anyone of the past 23 years of the joys, the heartaches, the worries, the frets. You know of times of just overwhelming happiness and times in the depths of loneliness. And Father, we can look now and see how your hand has been upon this little cup. And it is with the confidence of the past that we encourage yourself for the years of the future. As you have blessed Amy's grandparents with 50 great years together, and her parents with 25 years together, that same providence and kindness will be upon Josh and Amy in years to come. And Father, it is with that we ask for an invitation, your blessing, not upon an afternoon, but upon a lifetime and upon a union. And we do that in the name that you will not refuse, that of Jesus Christ. Amen. And that was my privilege to begin the ceremony today. It is my honor to ask this question. Who gives this woman to be married unto this man?
We do. Dearly beloved, we are gathered together here in the sight of God and in the presence of these witnesses to join together Amy and Josh in holy matrimony, which is an honorable state instituted of God and signifying unto us the mystical union which exists between Christ and his church, which holy estate Christ adorned and beautified with his presence in Cana of Galilee. It is therefore not to be entered into unadvisedly, but reverently, discreetly, and in the fear of God, and into this holy estate Amy and Josh come now to be joined. I require and charge you both, as you stand in the presence of God, before whom the secrets of all hearts are disclosed, that having duly considered the holy covenant you are about to make, you do now declare before this company your pledge of faith each to the other. Be well assured that if these solemn vows are kept inviolate, as God's word demands, and if steadfastly you endeavor to do the will of your heavenly Father, God will bless your marriage, will grant you fulfillment in it, and will establish your home of peace. Now, Josh, will you have Amy to be your wedded wife, to live together in the holy estate of matrimony? Will you love her, comfort her, honor and keep her, in sickness and in health, and forsaking all other, keep thee only under her so long as you both shall live?
I will.
And Amy, will you have Josh to be your wedded husband, to live together in the holy estate of matrimony? Will you love him, comfort him, honor and keep him, in sickness and in health, and forsaking all other, so long as you both shall live? Amy and Josh will be making their home together in Indianapolis, Indiana. They have been fortunate and thankful and guided by God to find a church family already there in Indianapolis. And we are pleased this afternoon to have their pastor, Al Edgington, come and share with us at this time.
Hi, Josh. You are beaming. You are glowing. I really think you want to get married. Amy, you love this guy. And he loves you. Well, I want to read from Genesis 2. On the back of your bulletin, you have some printed verses. Just a portion of what I'll read. It actually started in Genesis 1. Moses writes, God created man in his own image, and the image of God he created, a male and female, he created them. And he saw that what he had made was good, and there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Now I'm going to talk to you, Josh, and Amy. The rest can listen in. But this is a review. And if you don't pass, you don't get married. This is the Reader's Digest condensed version of what happened on day 6. He created the man and created the woman. And at the end of the day, he said everything was good. In fact, everything was very good. It was super good. It was hyper good. But when we come to Genesis 2, he zooms in on day six, and we look at it now in more detail. Starting in verse 18, Moses writes this, "And the Lord God said, it's not good." Now at the end of the day, Josh, he said, it is super good. But in the midst of that day, sometime within the hours of that sixth day, he said, it is not good for the man to be alone. Josh, do you agree with that? Unless God has gifted you with a celibate life, then it's not good for you to be alone. And he has provided someone for you. In fact, Moses goes on to say, I will make him a helper suitable for him. Amy, what's your thoughts about being a helper? You want to be Josh's helper? He wants you to be his helper. And the word suitable means corresponding to. I like the translation complimenting. Josh, you realize that she is going to compliment you. Not in the sense of, golly, Josh, I like your shoes. But in the sense of complete. You know, they say before you're married, you're incomplete. And after you're married, you're finished. We've already teased about this. Josh, before you're married, in a sense, you're incomplete. But now Amy is going to complete you. And that's going to be a neat union. And he's going to complete you. He goes on to say, out of the ground the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every bird of the sky and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called the living creature, that was its name. And he gave names to all the cattle and to the birds of the sky and every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found a helper suitable for him. Always wondered why in the midst of this passage on the creation of man and woman, he put the naming of the animals. Now picture this, Josh. Adam, standing on a rock probably, begins to see all these animals come by. And there's Mr. and Mrs. Hippopotamus, Mr. and Mrs. Rhinoceros, Mr. and Mrs. Monkey. And he begins to realize there's not someone suitable for him. No one corresponds to him. No one completes him. Even Zinzi is not man's best friend. Do you agree with that? Yeah. So he puts this in here so that sometime in the midst of day six, he realizes, I'm alone. God already realized it's not good for the man to be alone. Now he realizes he's alone, and he doesn't have that complement, that completer. So now he's ready for surgery. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. Then he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh at that place. God performed the first surgery and took from the man a portion of his side. And it says in verse 22, the Lord God fashioned, literally built. He built a woman out of that rib, which he'd taken from the man and brought her to the man. Now the rabbis, Josh, used to teach this. The reason he didn't take a portion of the man's head is because the woman might think that she's superior. And he didn't take a portion of his foot because then they might think that she was inferior. And I don't believe either. This is not an issue of inferiority and superiority. In fact, he took that which was closest to his heart because they're really equal in being. Now your function is different. Amy, you're to be his helper. He is your head. But you're equal in being before the Lord. And then it says, and he brought her to the man. Now picture this, Josh. He's just had major surgery. I can picture him laying under a shade tree in the garden. And he's been down deep and probably out for a while. because it says the Lord God caused a deep sleep. Have you ever waken up on the couch on a Sunday afternoon and you've been down deep and you're kind of groggy? Well, all of a sudden, he wakes up and there's Eve. And this is what he says. Wow, where have you been all my life? That's my free translation. This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. How does he know that? He's got a scar that he's going to carry for 930 years. He knows exactly where that woman came from. And Josh, when you have a tendency to get angry with Amy, just remember that everything she has came from you. This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. She shall be called Isha because she was taken out of Ish. And they began as one, didn't they? Then he goes on to say, for this cause a man shall leave his father and his mother and shall cleave to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. Just the way they start, they end up. Now we talked about three things: leave, cleave, and weave. Today you're leaving. That doesn't mean you don't love mom and dad anymore. Doesn't mean you won't visit them anymore. Doesn't mean you won't do things with them anymore. Doesn't mean on occasion they won't send you money. But you're leaving now today, and you're forming a new union. And you're going to cleave to each other, not in a prenuptial agreement, but in a covenant. You are promising each other to love each other till death do us part. It's a binding agreement and a promise before God. And then you're going to weave together into one flesh. You're going to be one-hearted. You're going to grow together in your emotions, even begin to think more alike. And of course, that will be really manifested in the one flesh relationship that you enjoy as husband and wife. You're going to be a team. You're going to be a team. You're going to be best friends. You're already best friends. And it's going to get even better. I can tell you that now, after going on 29 years of marriage, my wife is my buddy. And I love her more than anyone else. And Amy's going to be your best friend, Josh. And Josh, you'll be the best friend to Amy. And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed, because they had that oneness. And they shared their life together. And you're going to keep dating? Keep dating, right, Amy? Keep dating. And just cultivate that relationship deeper and deeper. Well, that's a review. How'd you do? You in agreement? Okay, we can go on then. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you for this reminder of a covenant that's being made today, promised before you to each other. Lord, for their specific and respective functions and roles, even though they're equal in Christ, there's a different job description. That they are now to be one in so many ways as they grow together as a team, best friends,